How many of you men know women make you do some dumb stuff sometimes? No disrespect, I'm just telling you. Sometimes we put blinders on when it comes to things. But, you know, I do want to welcome everybody to the Odyssey Church. I figured today would be a little bit light crowd since there's no air conditioning back here. We try to make it as cool as we can when you come in. But this has been the hottest week, and there's all kinds of heat warnings, and I'd rather people be safe than come out and risk any harm to themselves. Now, I know that most of you probably haven't noticed that my arm's in a sling. I know it's sort of a secret thing, but since I know some of you in here are very super perspective, I thought I would just let you know that I did have surgery on Tuesday. It was repair a tear in the muscle on my shoulder. It happened back in November of last year, the first Thursday in November. It's operated on December 29th. But as they told me, there's two parts of the operation. The first part is the operation itself, and the second part is the healing process. And it was a huge tear. Just it pulled the muscle completely ripped back off the shoulder. So this time, I got some used parts from some guy that I don't know that's passed away. I actually asked the doctor, I said, you know, can I choose the person that I get the parts from? Because I got some people that he told me no. He said, are they still alive? I said, not the one I got in mind. But I'm just kidding. The operation, hopefully, has been very successful. And if you're not a donor, I would really encourage you to do so, because that's what's helped me. The muscle was tore. They had to put some muscle implants from a cadaver. And that couldn't have been done if that somebody hadn't been unselfish and donated some of the things that they had when they left this world. And we all know we're going to leave one day. But I just tell you all that because after they sewed me up, I've got these cadaver implants on me. So if I just go all zombie on you, you're going to know why. But all kidding aside, honestly, I so much appreciate it. There's so many phone calls and texts and Facebook messages and emails from so many people. I really appreciate that. I didn't get a chance to answer them all, and I apologize. I've sort of tried to take it as easy as I can over the last couple of days. They told me the pain would be much worse this time because it was more extensive surgery, and quite frankly, it's been a lot less. So all praise and glory goes to God. I think I told you last week, if you were here, that there was a friend of mine that we had to go to the doctor to find out if he had terminal cancer this week, and all praise and glory to God. I'm going to send him to an oncologist because he's got a lot of weight loss. But he had three different CAT scans and there's no cancer visible right now. So God is just an amazing God. He is doing miracles today. Some people say that the time of miracles ended with the book of Acts. I don't believe that at all because I have seen it time and time and time again. And I believe the greatest miracle of all is a miracle that we can see outwardly. And that is the transformation of a lost soul who finds Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit and becomes regenerative and a new person in Christ. That is a miracle, and we should never take that lightly. But this morning, we're going to wrap up this series called Bad Girls of the Bible and what we can learn from them. And we're probably going to be talking about the baddest girl in the entire Bible. And when I say bad, I don't mean bad like we sometimes say, meaning good. I mean, this girl is so bad that she makes all our other bad girls that we've talked about look like good girls. But as I've been doing this series, and I sort of have to admit to you, it's not turning out exactly like I thought it would. Because, you know, being a man, I'm thinking I can go through these bad girls of the Bible and I can pick on them a little bit, and I can see all their sin and talk about their sin, and then I can use it for an object lesson, and hopefully we'll get some practical experience and what we can learn from it, how to apply it to our lives. But really, when I start going through these women, they're bad, but they're not nearly as bad as the men that are standing behind them. I mean, we've seen through these historical accounts that are recorded in the Word of God, it seems like the men are a whole lot worse off than the women. I mean, we started the messages out with a woman called the Witch of Endor, the medium of Endor, depending on the translation that you look at. And you would think, if you're talking about a medium or a witch, you can't go much wrong. I mean, she's a bad girl. I figured that is a safe way to start. A witch. There's no doubt a witch has to be a bad girl. Some say, you know, she was a compassionate helper, that she was a thoughtful hostess, because we see at the end of this account that's written in our scriptures, we see that she actually kills a fatted calf, and she cooks it, and she makes this elaborate dinner. She takes some dough and kneads it into bread and then bakes it, and she serves King Saul this great meal, sort of fit for a king. But we have to remember, when we're dealing with the witch of Endor, we're still dealing with what's forbidden by God. We have to understand that this witch, this medium, is the worst kind of girl, because she is going directly against what God has told her not to do. She is opposing God himself and his word. Yet she sort of makes herself look like a helpful soul by taking care of, being generous, and having this servant attitude. And let me assure you, that she was a very, very bad girl. The problem is, Saul, King Saul this time, was far worse. Now, he's a man who's anointed by God. He's a man who's the king of Israel, which is, you know, the nation of God, the one who uses as an example for all time. And he's supposed to be leading his people. He's supposed to be protecting his people. And where do we find him? Inquiring of the Lord and trusting in his word? No, we find the king of Israel inquiring from a sorcerer. He's in the witch's house. We find him at a place that God has condemned. And he's asking her questions, and he's trusting in her word. And he's asked her, and she does it. She raises the spirit of Samuel, who's risen up out of the earth. You know, sometimes I tell people, that's why you should read your Bibles. There is some really cool stuff in here, stuff that would make great movies. And they're historical accounts. This stuff, if you're a Christian, if you say you follow Jesus, we believe it. I mean, I know it sounds crazy at times, but we believe this is actual historical accounts. And, you know, the great thing about the Bible is it's so transparent. We only get two chapters in the Bible where everything's great. You know, we start with Genesis, which means beginning, and chapters 1 and 2 is God doing his thing, which was great, and by chapter 3, man's already messed it up, and the whole rest of the Bible is God telling us how much he loves us, and how much we mess up, and how much he still loves us, and how we can fix the problem where we messed up. You know, so often, we say things like, I can't wait to get to heaven so I can walk to Eve and find out why she ate that fruit. But if you go into Scripture and you begin to read in 2 Timothy, or in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 14, it says, and it was not Adam who was deceived by Satan, it was the woman who was deceived, and sin was the result. So, you know, you look at it at first glance, man, we look like we're okay. She was deceived. The result was sin. It was all her fault. The fact is, if you really read that carefully, what we find out is Eve had an excuse. She was deceived by Satan. Man had no excuse. He simply did what his wife told him to do. Now, if you're married, you probably understand. You know? Understand why Adam did what his wife told him to do. But it still makes them worse off than the woman. And I can't speak for the other men in this room, but I know I've done some pretty dumb stuff because my wife told me to do it. It was either because I loved her and I didn't want to upset her, or sometimes it was just to avoid the repercussions of not doing what she said for me to do. But the men, according to Scripture, were supposed to be the head of the household. Where was the head of Adam and Eve's household as Eve took the fruit and she handed it to Eve? Adam was far worse off than Eve. Then we look at Delilah, the fatal attraction. But it wasn't Delilah who had the fatal attraction, it was Samson. And Samson, you know, he's the judge of all of Israel at this time. He's the highest ranking leader. He's the ruler. He was supposed to be the judge of all of Israel, the highest ranking leader. He resigned. church or in the religious legal matters and in the governmental legal matters. But because of his fatal attraction to this bad girl Delilah, Samson, his actions, causes not only himself to become into chains and bondage and blinded, but all of the people that he was supposed to be ruling over are now in slavery and bondage due to his actions. And then finally, last week, you know, we looked at this girl, Jael. She's a liar, she's a deceiver, she's a murderer. But did God see her as a bad girl, or did God see her as a good girl? And if you don't know the answer to that, well, all our messages can be watched on our website, and I'm not going to tell you the answer. You've got to watch it for yourself. Or you can go to our YouTube channel, or the easiest way to watch them is to download our brand new Odyssey app. Just go to iTunes or Android and put the Odyssey Church in your smartphone, and you watch all our messages from our cell phone or from your tablet. And each week we're trying to hopefully improve that, but I'm the main person trying to work on that, and typing is getting harder, and I never had a lot of computer experience in the beginning, but support, so they have a great support team, and we're hoping to be able to have audio messages within a couple of months. But we have a great Bible app on there, a lot of study materials, and you know, as Rob talked about, when you get to the Odyssey Church, it's never about projects, it really isn't. We're hoping to open up on September 18th, our new revised, our new elementary age ministry right here at the Odyssey Church. And you might say, well, that's a project. It's not about the project. It's all about the people. We want to reach out into this community and change their lives for the better. So there's even a way on there that you can just simply text sponsor TOC to 7797 and give online, as simple as that. So really a great app. Take your time, watch it over, and hopefully each week you'll see a few more improvements. But as we get started this morning, you know, how many of you, and maybe you need to ask yourself this question like I did, how many of people do you know that are very, very talented people, but they keep making one bad decision after another, and they never live up to their greatest potential? You know? Many of you may not know this. If you don't know me, you may not know that I spent about 20 plus years in the automobile industry. And most of that time, I was in some form of management. And during this time, I met some of the most talented, some of the most gifted people the world has ever seen. I mean, they were so many great people. They had great personalities. They had great leadership abilities. They had great people skills. But the majority of them made bad decisions on a daily basis. And those bad decisions kept them from ever achieving their greatest potential. They kept them from ever being able to achieve the success that they were capable of. For a lot of them, it was drugs and alcohol. They had addiction problems. They played as hard as they worked, but their talents, their need for self-gratification, led them into areas that they should never be in. For some of them, it was just simply the lure of the opposite sex. For some of them, it was greed. For almost all of them, it was for the things of this world which they were coveting. It was for worldly gain. And for many, many, many of them, they had all the above. Somewhere along the line, these people just kept making poor decisions. Poor choices, things that kept leading them deeper and deeper and deeper into areas they shouldn't be in, and they never reached their greatest potential. I remember one of the salespeople, he was probably the best salesperson, the best communicator, had the best people skills of any man I've ever met in any profession. He was an amazing salesperson. I remember one time we both worked at a Toyota dealership, and we were standing by the front window, and we looked as this car drove in with this guy and his wife and two or three kids, And as they got out of the car, they parked right in front of this white Corolla, and I mean, they were all over, they were peering through the windows. You could almost see them salivating from inside the dealership. It was obvious they loved this car. The salesperson looks to me and says, "What car do you want me to sell?" And I'm naive, you know, I said, "Sell them the maroon Corolla. They love the white car." He looks right me dead in the eye and says, "Nah, that'd be too easy." He said, let me sell them that black Camry way over there. Now I'm thinking, there ain't no way. It's opposite color. It's not close to being the same car. It's not hundreds, but thousands of dollars more. They're already in love with this white Corolla. There is no way he's going to get them to sell, to buy this black Corolla Camry. Out there, many people driving out in a brand new black Camry with a great big smile on their face. You know, with all this man's talent, with all his knowledge, with all his abilities, communication, and people skills, this man just couldn't manage his own life. He used all of these skills that he had for all the wrong reasons. He used his persuasive skills to be promiscuous, even though he was married, and most of the women that he tried to date and did date were married as well. He was a severe, severe alcoholic. He actually kept a cooler, which was more like a bar. I mean, it was set up with the different kinds of alcohol, his ice, his mixers, in the trunk of his car. By 3:00 in the afternoon, he was totally wasted on the showroom floor. He was a bad gambler. He made tons and tons and tons of money. Money most of us never see, but he used it all for his bad habits. He couldn't manage his personal life. He kept missing work. He didn't go home to his wife. And even though he made this company a lot of money, and I mean a lot of money, his actions affected everybody around him. And we had to terminate him for him. His actions had consequences. And those consequences affected himself, affected the people he loved, affected those that he had influence over. With all his talent, the decisions he made on a daily basis cost him his health, probably, or at least should have cost him his marriage. It cost him the women he had affairs with their marriage. And I know this because I know some of them. The decision he made on his daily basis not only influenced his wife, but influenced the wife's lover. And some of those were the people he loved, like his wife and his family. Some of those were the people that were closest to him, like his friends. And it affected everybody else he came into contact with. With all his God-given talent, his poor decisions brought him hurt, pain, and chaos to himself and to everybody he came into contact with. I remember right after we stopped working together and I sort of went into business for myself, he picked the wrong girl the best way. He was very persuasive, but this girl had a very jealous boyfriend. One night as he walked out of the nightclub, two guys attacked him with pool sticks and just left him for dead. I mean, he spent several days in a hospital, and it took him months and months and months to recover. This man with all these great abilities, he could have had anything in the world he wanted, but one bad decision after another cost him everything he had, all because of these personal poor decisions, these poor choices, these bad decisions. Last time I saw him was actually up at BJ's. I had been down here for a couple years. I hadn't seen him in maybe 5 or 6 years. It was only a couple months before he passed away. He was bloated, he was fire engine red, and he had hundreds of these little white pus sores all over him. He stopped me, we had a little small talk, but he looked so horrible physically that it wasn't until I walked away that I could remember who he actually was by his voice, not by his appearance. And we had worked together on and off for years. But his decision not only affected him personally, but his poor decision affected the lives of the people he loved and the lives of everybody he came into contact with. And not all of his decisions had immediate consequences. You know, some of them took late years to come around, but sooner or later the consequences came. And the point is that he could change the direction of his life at any time he chose to do so by just making better decisions. But he never did. He was rebellious to the very end, and he died just like he lived. Horrible. Now, this man's story, the reason I tell you this is because it's not much different than the man and woman that we're going to be talking about this morning. In the Old Testament, woven throughout 1 Kings and 2 Kings, beginning in about chapter 16 of 1 Kings, is a story of a king and his queen. Now, you know, we couldn't do a series called Bad Girls of the Bible and not eventually get to the baddest girl of them all. One of the scholars have called the wickedest woman in all the world. And I know you know who it is by now. It's the woman, it's the bad girl I'm talking about. It's a girl by the name of Jezebel. Now, some of the things you may not know about Jezebel. Jezebel actually ruled for over three decades, over 30 years. She was the daughter of a king. She was the wife of the king. She was the mother and the grandmother of kings. Ooh. But she was not a good daughter. She was not a good husband or a good wife. She was not a good mother or not a good grandmother. According to the record, there is not even a mention of her having even one friend. In fact, as we think about her name even tells us a story. Her name has become part of our vocabulary. I mean, her name, if you look it up in a dictionary, if you look up the word Jezebel, it will tell you a shameless, wicked woman. If you call a woman a Jezebel, you better watch out because everybody knows exactly what you're talking about. But like I said earlier, as we've gone through this series, what we find out is behind every bad girl, he's a worse man. And today is no different. As much as I'd love to tell you about all the bad things she did and all the things that she was capable of, all the things that are recorded in these ancient documents we call our Bibles, the Bible actually credits all this evil, once again, to the man. King Ahab. He made just one bad decision. Right after another bad decision, right after another bad decision, which left this bad girl's evil just go unchecked. Even Jesus speaks about her. In the book of Revelation to the church of Thyatira, he said, I have this against you, that you tolerate that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. Now, how bad do you have to be for Jesus to condemn you for simply tolerating her? What I want you to see this morning, in case you drift off, in case you have to leave early, I'm just going to tell you the points of the day's message right up front. Every decision you make will not only affect your life, it will affect the life of the people that you love, it will affect the life of the people that you are closest to, and it will affect everybody that you have influence over. And we influence everybody we come into contact, either in a small way or a bad way. Well, I mean in a big way. Our decisions, every decision we make, and you don't think about this often, affects everybody around us. But the good news is, as long as you're still breathing, as long as you still have breath in your lungs, as long as you can still blow smoke on a mirror, you can begin to make better choices beginning today, and you can still reach your potential. If you're in here this morning, there's still time to have the life that Jesus came to give you, a life that he says he wants you to have, which is rich and satisfying. It's the life he lived for you, that he died for you, and that he rose again to give you. So we're introduced to this king and queen In chapter 16 of 1 Kings, beginning in verse 29 and 30, Ahab, son of Omri, began to rule over Israel in the 38th year of King Asa's reign in Judah. At this time, Israel had been split into two nations, Israel and Judah. Ahab reigned in Samaria 22 years, but Ahab, the son of Omri, did what was evil in the Lord's sight, even more than any of the kings before him. That's a lot of evil. There was a lot of bad kings. So we have to ask ourselves, you know, this question. What is this evil? What is this evil that King Ahab did that made him so much worse than every other king? And as I've really studied these scriptures, and I think if you do the same thing, what you're going to find out, his greatest evil was simply tolerating what Jezebel was doing. It was simply the poor decisions he made, one right after another. And these decisions, these poor decisions, affected his life. It affected the lives of those around him. It even affected the entire nation of Israel. He went against what the Word of God says, and he stepped into sin. And I'm not trying to judge him or anybody for that, because we all know we've done it, right? We've all, at times, been disobedient. But continual disobedience to God can make the difference between a life with God and a life separated from God. So we have to sort of begin to ask ourselves these type of questions. Do we let our next decision be a bad decision, or lead to another bad decision, to another bad decision, or do we simply repent? And repent simply means change the way you think, so you change the way you act, and let the next decision be a better decision, to be the right decision. So what I'm going to do this morning is sort of give you the backstory so a lot of this makes sense and you can sort of understand why Jezebel was the way she was. The account really starts with the princess of Phoenicia, or as it's sometimes called, and most of the time in Scripture, it's called Sidon. And the king of Phoenicia was a man by the name of Ethbaal. And Ethbaal was a devout worshiper of the god Baal. As king of Phoenicia, now he's not only their political leader, he's not only their military leader, but as the king of Phoenicia, or the king of Sidon, he was also their religious leader. Jezebel's dad is going to teach her, by example, what it is to be a strong military leader, a strong political leader. What this man said was never questioned. He had no accountability. What he wanted, he always got. And his daughter would have grown up seeing this. His daughter would have also grown up to be this devout worshiper of Baal and his female partner, Ashtoreth. Now Baal, the male god, was to be the god of the land. The Phoenicians or the Sidonians, they believed that he owned all the land in the world, that he controlled all the weather, he controlled the increase of their crops, he controlled the multiplication of their cattle, that he had complete control over almost everything. And his female partner, Ashtoreth, was considered to be the mother goddess of all fertility. The idols of Baal and Ashtoreth would stand side by side in these pagan temples. They were worshipped by the priests, and they had thousands of temple prostitutes. And they would do these suggested dances. They would have these sacred orgies. These were the gods of love. But unfortunately, it was Eros love, not agape love. And Eros love is sexual love, where agape love is unconditional. So when things got tough, like in the times of a famine, and they would think that these gods were in opposition to them, in order to please them, they'd start to do things. If they wanted them to perform a certain task, the priests would begin to slash themselves and cut themselves and let the blood spill over into the floor. They're trying to appease Baal and Asherah to get them to help them. The Phoenicians or the Sidonians. They at the time in history, Syria and the Assyrians were becoming great threats to all the surrounding countries around them. And in order to increase their strength, the king of the Phoenicians, Baal, would marry off some of his daughters to other kings. That would give him power over the other countries. And to King Ahab, the king of Israel, he sent Jezebel to be married to Ahab. They made a treaty, and they settled it by marriage. Now Jezebel, this devout worshiper of Baal, came in and almost took over control immediately. Ahab was a capable ruler. He was a powerful ruler in the northern kingdom of Israel. He was like his father. Ahab demonstrated impressive military skills. He was able to sustain a strong and a stable government. Historically, Ahab was a political success story. But the Bible paints this different picture. One which focuses more on his poor personal choices, his bad decisions. By marrying Jezebel, Ahab began this downward spiral, which is going to lead to the death of his loved ones. It's going to lead the nation of Israel deeper and deeper into sin. It's going to lead to his death, his wife's death, his kids' death. And it's going to lead Israel all the way down until God has to pronounce judgment through the prophet Elijah. Ahab's going to be killed, his family's going to be killed, all the people he had influence over, the entire nation of Israel is going to be judged by God. And for all his political success, Ahab's legacy, what he's remembered in history for, is one of personal and national evil. And it's all because of choices he made, the decisions he made. And the important thing is, he could have changed those at any time. But Ahab, the son of Omri, did what was evil in the Lord's sight, even more than all the kings before him. So this morning, I just want you to ask yourself, what will your legacy be? What will my legacy be? Are we going to make the right choices, or are we going to make good decisions, or are we going to let our personal weaknesses control us and let us make decisions? They're not only going to affect us, but going to affect the people we love, the people that we're closest to, the people we have influence over. Will we, by the decision we make, reach our greatest potential? Jezebel, as she's recorded in history, was headstrong, self-willed, a domineering woman, and a fanatical worship of Baal. We're introduced to her and her husband in 1 Kings chapter 16, beginning in verse 31, 34. We see Jezebel. And as though it were not enough to follow the example of Jeroboam, so here's Ahab, he makes the decision to follow a bad example. Then he makes another bad decision. He married Jezebel, the daughter of King Ethbaal, of the Sidonians, or as we know them, the Phoenicians, and he began to bow down in worship of Baal. One bad decision, another bad decision, another bad decision, and that leads into another bad decision. First, he built a temple and an altar for Baal in Samaria. Then he set up an altar for Baal in the temple of Baal, which he had built in Samaria, and Ahab had made a wooden image. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel which were before him. One simple bad decision to follow an example he knew he shouldn't follow, Jeroboam. That led to another bad example, marry a woman he knew God had forbidden him to marry. That followed by another bad decision, to worship a false god and to set up temples and to set up altars and to make wooden images and wooden idols, which the Bible prohibited, God's Word prohibited. One bad decision after another until it cost Ahab everything. It was during this reign that Hiel, a man from Bethel, rebuilt Jericho. Now, I'm sure this was under the orders of Ahab. And if you remember, Jericho was the walls of the pagan city that God had torn down. When he laid its foundation, it cost him the life of his oldest son, Abiram. And when he completed it and set up its gate, it cost him the life of his younger son, Sego. This all happened according to the message from the Lord concerning Jericho, spoken by the son, Joshua, son of Nun. These things were predicted years and years and years ago. A bad decision to go against what God had told him not to do. God always keeps his promises. And bad decisions have bad results. The simple decision that led to another bad decision, that led to another bad decision, that led to another bad decision, ultimately led to Ahab's death, Jezebel's death, their kids' death, and the entire nation of Israel being under the judgment of God. And Ahab had the ability to stop all of this just by making the next decision the right decision. Have you ever done that? Have you ever made a bad decision and that bad decision led to another bad decision? No. I mean, I really wish I could sit up and tell you that I have never done that. But I have to tell you, I have done it more times than I would like to admit. I make a bad decision, I think, well, you know, if I do this, I'll get out of that, and I'm just digging myself a deeper and deeper and deeper hole. Mm-hmm. This king of Israel, Ahab, should have put a stop to this pagan worship, which was a direct violation of God's first and second commandments. But he didn't. His greatest evil was that he just simply tolerated Jezebel's worship of Baal and even built temples for her to worship at, and then began to worship with her. These kind of decisions never start out as a big decision. You don't start out saying, I'm going to worship Baal. He started out saying, that's a pretty girl. I think I'd like to be with her. You know, I really don't want to fight against this other king, so I get to marry her at night. That is a great decision. Sin has a way of sneaking up on us, doesn't it? Little decisions lead to big decisions. And the next thing you know it, you're in big trouble. Now, I have to imagine to Ahab, and particularly to Jezebel, that the worship of the one true God was a little boring. You know? I sort of imagine it in today's time. We have the Odyssey Church here. And unlike a lot of churches today, we try to speak on full counsel of God. We talk about God's wrath, and we talk about God's grace. We have to know both, or you can't understand either. We talk about obedience and what happens if you're disobedient. But across the street, there's a house of prostitution that says they're a church, and they're throwing wild parties. And they say, this is the way to God. So you're walking down the street, and you say, I'm going to behave over here, or I can do whatever I want over here. And they both say, I'm going to lead to the same place. And we know where most of the world goes. So when King Ahab is introduced to all this immorality, it had to be appealing. And to Jezebel, it's all she knew. She wasn't about to give up all her ways to serve the one true God. But the problem went deeper than that. Jezebel not only introduces the worship of Baal, she wanted to wipe out the worship of Jehovah altogether, the one true God. She taught that she had divine revelation. She taught she knew the way of God. She taught that she knew the truths, the deep truths of God. Ahab just simply tolerated. She began to kill off the prophets of the one true God. Her first official act as queen was to order that the priest, the Jewish priest, be killed. She was doing away with God's spiritual leaders, and she was replacing them with the prophets of Baal. And all along, King Ahab simply makes the decision to tolerate this behavior. You know, sometimes we think if we don't do anything, we can't get in any trouble. But a decision not to do anything is still a decision. And sometimes a decision not to do anything can be the worst decision you can make. King Ahab's personal choices allowed her to try and replace the worship of the one true God completely. The worship of false gods to come in and take over completely. She introduced idolatry again to the people of Israel. One bad decision, just leading to another bad decision. This stubborn, self-willed, headstrong wife of Ahab began to cause disruption and distress for Israel, not for a little while, but for years and years to come. And Ahab just continued to tolerate her behavior. But here's the good news. God in His grace and God in His mercy gives time for both King Ahab and Jezebel to repent. Now, if I was God, and I speak like a fool, you know, I'd have given up on both of them a long time ago. I would have said, there's no hope for them. But our God doesn't do that. He's graceful. He's merciful. He says He's long-suffering. The decisions we make, good or bad, good or bad, affects the way we live, both in this life and in the next life. Elijah had preached and shown God to be the one true God. King Ahab and this self-appointed prophetess Jezebel taught that it was Baal, and they refused to listen to the prophets of God and the Word of God. And there comes a time, and we all know this, there comes a time when God patience. A God who said, I am long-suffering. Long-suffering means patient. God who says, I am patient. For a long time. But there comes a time when that patient runs out. He does not say, I'm forever suffering. He does not say, I'm forever. Sooner or later, God's patience runs out and judgment must take place. Decisions we make, good or bad, have real consequences in both this life and the next life. For Ahab, even though some people say, and it's sort of maybe he did repent in his later life, There are always consequences for sin. And for Ahab, it comes on a battlefield. 1 Kings, moving into chapter 22, verses 34 to 37, says, an Aramean soldier, however, randomly shot an arrow into the air at the Israelite troops, and it hit the king of Israel between the joints of his armor. Turn the horses and get me out of here, Ahab groaned to the driver of his chariot. I am badly wounded. The battle raged all that day, and the king remained propped up in his chariot facing the Arameans. The blood from his wound ran down to the floor of his chariot, and as evening arrived, he died. Just as the sun was setting, the cry ran through the troops. We're done for. Run for your lives. So the king died, and his body was taken to Samaria and buried there. Then his chariot was washed beside the pool of Samaria, and dogs came and licked his blood at the place where the prostitute stood, just as the Lord had promised. This was earlier. The prophet of Elijah saw Ahab had taken a vineyard. Actually, it was Jezebel, and she had killed the landowner. She had killed his sons. And Elijah comes out of the hiding and says, for this, the dogs will lick your blood, and gave a worse prophecy for we can answer that. So the first thing I want you to see this way is this. Our decisions, good or bad, will affect us personally, and sometimes in the most extreme way. So the King God. Whether good or bad, our decisions have consequences on our own life. And sometimes our bad decisions don't have consequences right away. But when God delays, it does not mean God is absent. When God delays, it doesn't mean God is absent. My dad was a 5-pack-a-day smoker. That means he smoked a half a carton of cigarettes a day.
Whoa.
I've been sitting in his office before, watch a cigarette burning in the ashtray as he's smoking a cigarette. It gets to the end, and he lights a cigarette with a cigarette. And he's got 3 cigarettes burning at the same time. So a couple months after his 62nd birthday, when he was diagnosed with lung cancer and then died 6 weeks later, it didn't come as a total surprise. It was hard, but it wasn't totally shocking. He smoked for 50 years. The consequences of his bad decision didn't happen right away. But when it came in the most extreme way. When God is sovereign, it doesn't mean that God is absent. Now that can be both good news and bad news, depending on whether your next decision is a good decision or a bad decision. Consequences of both our good decisions and our bad decisions don't always come right away. See, for Jezebel, her punishment didn't come for another 14 years. But her punishment was part. It was a violent death. Moving into 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 30 through 37, when Jezebel, the queen mother, heard that Jehu had come from Jezreel, she painted her eyelids and fixed her hair and sat at the window. She made herself look like the queen she thought she was, and she's sitting on the top floor looking out the window. And when Jehu entered the gate of the palace, she shouted, "Hey, you come in peace, you murderer?" Thinking, that's probably not the way to talk to the guy who's coming in to take over your town. You're just like Zimri, who murdered his master. Jehu looked up at her and saw her at the window and shouted, "Who is on my side?" And you got to remember, she treated everybody the same. Nobody was left out. 2 or 3 of the eunuchs looked out at him, and I believe everybody around her hated her as much as the next person, as much as Jehu did. So 2 or 3 eunuchs looked down and they threw her out the window. Blood spattered against the wall and on the horses. And Jehu trampled her body under the horses' hooves. So here's this man, Jehu, he just had the queen thrown out of her window, and as she rolled down, there's blood spattered against the wall, her body's all broken up, but that's not enough for him. He gets the horse he's on to start trampling over. And it must have really upset him, because look what he did next. Jehu went into the palace and he ate and drank. Don't seem to bother him at all, did it? So after he got filled, he got everything he needed, and he said, "You know what? You go outside and bury this cursed woman. Well, she is the daughter of the king. But she was still a queen. She deserves a proper burial. Let's give her a queen. Let's give her a proper burial." But when they went out, they found her. They found only her skull, her feet, and her hands. When they returned and told Jehu, he stated, "This fulfills the message from the Lord, the message from Elijah the prophet, which he spoke to his servant Elijah from Tishbe, at the plot of land in Jezreel." This is the plot of land she stole, killed the owners, killed his kids. "Dogs will eat Jezebel's body. Her remains will be scattered like dung on the plot of land in Jezreel, so that no one will be able to recognize." Just because God is silent doesn't mean God is absent. He always keeps his promises. There are always consequences to our poor decisions. We may not get the consequences right away. We may not get the repercussions of our bad decisions right away, or even our good decisions. And they may not come for years, but they will come. Maybe there's something here that you never considered until today. Because not only love, Rob and Kara, you know, Ford has been here, and I've had the privilege of watching them. Sometimes the kids that come here come from really difficult families. And I don't mean that other to make a point. People live the way they live sometimes because of past experiences, whatever. But how many times have we looked at somebody and said, I feel so sorry for them because of how they're growing up? The poor decisions of their parents have affected their kids. And I know that they love their kids. Our poor decisions affect the people we love. But so do our good decisions. And the choice whether we make bad decisions or good decisions are up to us. Just because God is silent doesn't mean God is absent. Our decisions affect the people we love, the people that we're closest to. Not only was Ahab killed, not only was Jezebel killed, but the story goes on, and every one of her male children and her family were killed. There was about 70 of them all, and they were all violent deaths. But once again, God begins to illustrate what it cost us and those around us when we begin to disobey His word. Ahab made decisions which led him into sin. He tolerated the teachings of false doctrine. He tolerated his wife Jezebel, the self-appointed prophetess of Baal. And then he tolerated the false doctrine she was preaching. He did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. See, when we make bad decisions, it not only affects us, it not only affects those that are closest to us, the ones we love, but it also affects everybody we have influence over. And we have to remember, we have influence. It might be a small influence, it might be a large influence over everybody we meet. Talk to somebody in the grocery store. How many people are talking to somebody that was so negative they had an impact on you when you left? So I never want to be like that person. And by the same token, how many times have you been standing in line and talked to somebody and you left? And you say, you know, that is really a great person. I think I could be their friend. Everybody we come into contact with, we have some kind of influence on. And our decisions, how we act, and how we act is based on our decisions, we have influence over. But it even goes deeper than that. If you say that you believe in Jesus, if you say and claim to be a follower of Jesus, then you have to know at some time John has to judge that our decisions that we make, whether bad or good, not only have consequences in this life, they have consequences in the next life. I mean, look at Ahab and Jezebel. They're killed. Their children are killed. Those they love died because of their bad decisions. And if you know the history of Israel, then you know that God judges both corporately and individually. God judged the entire nation of Israel for the bad decisions their king and queen made to lead them into the false idols and the false gods which Jezebel taught. And Ahab tolerated. The next chapter, 2 Kings chapter 1, just starts out like this. After Ahab's death, Moab rebelled against Israel. God uses Moab, their enemy, as an instrument of punishment for the entire nation of Israel, all because of the decision that King Ahab made and what he taught the people he had influence over to follow. But here's the good news. Because you know it ain't gospel unless it's good news. And it's really, really good news because no matter how bad you've been, no matter how many bad decisions you made, even if you've led an entire nation into idolatry and idol worship, no matter how many bad choices you made, God still loves you God still wants you to repent and make things right with Him. But He warns us. He warns us. There's going to be terrible consequences for us to pay if we don't make the right decision. They may not come right away, but they will come. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, always has the final word. In the book of Revelation, Jesus tells us He even gave Jezebel the opportunity to repent. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 20, it says, "Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel who calls herself a prophetess. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols." Listen to this. "I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling." Can you imagine that? God gives Jezebel, the wickedest woman the Bible has to offer us, the wickedest woman, some say, in the entire world, He still loves her so much that He gives her time to repent. But the fact is, we have to be willing to do so. Because sooner or later, time runs out. Verse 21 and 23 of chapter 2 in the book of Revelation says, "So I will cast her into a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am He who searches hearts and minds and repay each one of you according to your deeds." Your sin will affect you. Your sin will affect those that you love and those that you are closest to, and your sin will affect everybody around you. But Jesus says you can repent at any time. You can make better decisions at any time. You can make things right with your Heavenly Father. And so often, we just simply need, we're going to talk a little bit about this next week, because the church has messed repentance up so much. Repentance just means turning from sin, turning from our bad decisions, which just is going to lead to death and suffering in this world and in the next world. And to start making better decisions, to make good decisions, which leads to eternal life and eternal pleasure. And the good news here is, if you're here this morning, if you're listening to this, if you're still breathing, there is time. There is time to still start making better decisions. Now, maybe you've already made the eternal decision. You know heaven is your future home, but the decisions that you make on a daily basis keep you from reaching your greatest potential. See, God gives us time in His mercy. I mean, how great is that? To decide to follow Him, to live for Him, to live the life Jesus Christ came to give us. And He clearly tells us the life He wants us to have. Jesus said, "My purpose is to give them." Give them means you. Give them means me. My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life. John 10:10. God wants us. He sent His Son to us. Sent His Son to walk among us, to live for us, to die for us, to rise again, just so we can reach our greatest potential. But our amazing God loves us so much, He will not make the decision for us. He leaves that up to you. And nobody but you can make that decision. Have you made some bad decisions in your life? And I know I have. We all have. Have you allowed one bad decision to lead you into another bad decision, and then you try to cover that up with another bad decision? Well, the good news here is, if you're here this morning, you're still breathing, there's still time to repent, there's still time to turn around, there's still time to start making better decisions. But Jesus warns us, time is running out, and we never know what time it is. We never know when that time will run out. God said, "I search your heart. I search your minds. And I will repay you according to your deeds." Your deeds. You make the decision. You decide. Good decisions lead to good deeds. Bad decisions lead to bad deeds. These aren't my words. These are the words of God. So I remind you this morning, here at the Odyssey Church, the altars here are always on. You know, maybe somebody just needs to lay down some of those bad decisions that you've made in the past. One of the most merciful things I think that our God does, the living God does, is give us a chance to repent, a chance to turn around, a chance to change our ways, a chance to change, to make better decisions, to change directions so we can reach our greatest potential and live this rich and satisfying life He wants us to live. For years, I made bad decisions, one right after another. And there were always consequences for those decisions. Some came real fast, and some took years. Here's the thing. God never gave up. And He'll never give up on you. I still make bad decisions from time to time. I'm not where I want to be, but thank God I ain't where I used to be. Because nobody's perfect. We all make bad decisions. We're all prone to wander at times. But the amazing thing is our God is long-suffering. He's patient. And He gives us time to make the right decision to repent. God does not give up on us. God gave Jezebel, a lady who's known to be sinless, a lady who's known to be wicked, a lady that was so awful throughout history. She's made it into our modern-day dictionary. She's a synonym for a wicked woman. But God gave Jezebel time to change her ways, to change her bad decisions into good decisions. She has given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unworthy. God would give somebody like Jezebel time to make the better decisions to repent. Don't you think He'll do the same thing for you? I mean, I'm looking around. As far as I know, as far as I can tell, there's nobody in here that has driven a whole nation into sexual immorality and false gods. Most of us look like angels compared to Jezebel. That maybe in God's sovereignty, that's why you're here this morning. So you can know that all the bad decisions that you made in your life, that they don't have to continue to affect you. They don't have to continue to affect your loved ones. There may be some consequences, but you can start making better decisions right now, right here. And when you do, you got to remember, I'm living proof. God took a used car salesman and made him a preacher. When we repent, when we make our minds up to make better decisions, we get better results. And God begins to pour out His blessings on us once again. But the path we take, He leaves up to each one of us individually. You have to make it yourself. Your friends can't make it. Your mama can't make it. Your daddy can't make it. You have to make the decision this morning. So I'm going to leave you by giving you some questions to ask yourself before you make a decision. When you're not sure if the decision you're about to make is the right decision, just ask yourself these questions. Does the Bible prohibit this action? Just a clue. The Bible says don't do it. It's probably a good idea not to do it. Okay? Does this decision take away from me loving God? Does this decision take me away from worshiping God? Does this decision take me away from serving God? If it does, don't do it. Does this decision make me a slave? Folks, I've never met one person who said, you know, I'm glad I smoked that first cigarette because I always wanted to be an addict. I've never met one person who said, you know, I am so glad I started on drugs because I just love to give my money away and have no control over my life. Does this decision make me a slave? Is it something that could lead to an addiction, alcohol, drugs, cigarettes, sex? Does it make you want to covet something or want something that's not yours? If it does, make a different decision. Does this decision benefit others? See, here's the thing. For years, I didn't make bad decisions in my mind. My decisions were good decisions for me. they were not good for everybody else. In order for me to have, I had to take from somebody else. You know, in order for me to have, I had to sell somebody something. Sometimes it was in service, but most of the time, honestly, if I'm really, really honest, it was for the commission. It was for me. It's just for me. It doesn't mean that sales is bad. Please don't misinterpret that. But does it benefit the other person? Does this decision fulfill God's purpose for my life? Or does it go against God's purpose for my life? Will this decision bring out the best in me? Will it let me live a rich and satisfying life? Will it help me have and live up to my greatest potential? Finally, I believe this is the most important question of all. Will this decision glorify God? See, if you answer these questions honestly, you'll make the right decisions. And folks, I'm here to tell you, if you made the wrong decisions, you can repent and start over, and you can do it starting right now. And there may be earthly consequences, but there won't be eternal consequences. See, we have to remember, King Ahab wasn't the only king of Israel to make bad decisions. Maybe some of you know the story. Maybe some of you heard it in Sunday school. Maybe you've read it in your Bible. But King David was a man who made bad decisions at times. He made the bad decision to stay at home when he should have been in the bad battlefield with his warriors. He made the bad decision to look over the wall and see a woman bathing. And he began to lust after her. He made the bad decision to get his men to bring her to her. He found out she was married to one of his best friends. But he made the decision to have an adulterous affair with her anyway, which led to her becoming pregnant, which led to the bad decision of him committing murder, killing this woman named Bathsheba's husband. One terrible decision after another. One bad decision led to another bad decision, led to another and another. And all of a sudden, David has coveted. He's lustful. He's an adulterer. He's a thief. He's a murderer, among many, many other things. But David repented. And God says in the book of Acts, chapter 13, verse 22, David, the son of Jesse, is a man after my own heart who will do my will. If you want to read about what true repentance is like, read Psalm 51. It's an example of man's sin and what it looks like to truly repent in God's grace and God's mercy and God's love for His people. Have you made some bad decisions? We each have to ask ourselves, am I going to make the right choice? Am I going to make the right decisions? Or am I going to let my personal weaknesses control me and let me make decisions which not only going to affect me, but affect the people that I love, the people that I'm closest to, the people that I have influence over? See, here's the thing. When we think of Jezebel, all kinds of evil comes to our mind. But what made Jezebel the evilest woman of all, the baddest of the bad girls? Was it because she was domineering and controlling? Was it because of her murderous ways? Was it because she killed the prophets of God? Was it because she led an entire nation into adultery? All those things were bad. But that is not what Jesus said made her so awful. What made Jezebel the baddest of the baddest girls was simply she never repented. She never started making good decisions. She kept making bad decisions. All she did, all the damage she did under her reign as queen, all the evil ways could have been totally forgiven. She'd just been willing to make the right decision, the good decisions for man. Jesus finishes up Revelation chapter 2 with these words. He or she who overcomes and keeps my works to the end, one who doesn't give up, keeps my work to the end, I will give him power. I will give her power over all the nations. He or she shall rule them with a rod of iron. They shall be dashed to pieces like the potter's vessel. As I have also received from my Father, I will give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit has to say to the church. Let us leave this morning with this wonderful truth of God. No matter what we've done, no matter how bad our decisions have been, even if you've led an entire nation astray, he who overcomes, the Father will give us the morning star. What is the morning star? It's the last thing Jesus calls himself in our scripture. The last thing he calls himself. Revelation chapter 22, 16. I, Jesus, have sent my angels to give you the testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright morning star.
Amen.
Here's the truth of the gospel. In other words, what God is saying, when we make better decisions, when we repent, God will give us all his power. God will even give us his Son, Jesus Christ, the morning star. Put it simply. There is victory in Jesus.
Amen.
What is your legacy going to be? Will it be one of bad decisions or one of good decisions? Who's going to control you? Your personal weaknesses or the Holy Spirit? Will your decisions, the things, the choices you make, be a positive influence on you and on your life and on the people that you love? Will the decision you make help you reach your greatest potential and live the rich and satisfying life Jesus came to you? Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your word. Father, sometimes we read our scriptures, la, 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 and there's so much in here for us to learn. Father, each time we read them, it's like peeling an onion. We go deeper and deeper and deeper again. You begin to reveal more and more to us. Father, your word tells us that we're stiff-necked. Since the fall of man, we're prone to make the wrong decisions. That we have to purposely and consciously sometimes go against ourselves to make the right decision. But you tell us the rewards of that are so great. Father, I pray today if there's one in here that doesn't know you, that's never made the decision to ask you into their heart and let you rule over their lives, that today be the day of their salvation. And Father, there's people that are like me in here today, that even though we love you, we know our eternal salvation is secure. The decisions we make sometimes on a daily basis lead us to bad places. They hurt people we love. Father, help us, Lord, to ask the questions that we presented this morning. And as we make decisions, let us know that they're going to have an impact and that we want these impacts to be positive. And Father, we just ask you, knowing that we can't do it on our own, but we thank you so much for your Son.